Comfort Toffle, A Tale of Moomin Valley, written by Tove Jansson. English version by Sophie Hanna. Who lives inside this little house? It's Toffle all alone. Poor Toffle doesn't notice quite how lonely he has grown. Outside, he hears the groat's shrill howl, Himmelin's heavy tread, as nervously he lights his lamps to guide his way to bed. Around him, forest creatures close their doors against the night, and keep each other safe from harm with smiles and warmth and light. But Toffle's feeling cold and sad, with no companion near. He burrows under bedclothes, body shivering with fear. But who will comfort Toffle? Tell him, hush now, it's okay. Life's bound to seem much brighter when tomorrow comes your way. Next morning, in the foggy gray, before the sun comes out, Toffle decides to step outdoors and have a peek about. He made it through the night, but he would rather eat his hat for breakfast every day than spend another night like that. He packs his case and runs head first into the misty gloom. Then looking back, he sees that all the lamps inside his room are burning low. When Toffle left, he didn't close his door, and now he groans to think of raindrops dripping on his floor. But who will comfort Toffle? For in fact a happy band of fellow Toffles moved straight in and took the place in hand. So Toffle walks for miles until he sees a crowd of folk, all laughing with each other, taking time to share a joke. But no one spots poor Toffle, and he guesses with dismay that nobody will notice him or even look his way. He watches from the shadows as four filly junks scoot past, and eight contented Woompas, each more jolly than the last. Mimble and me, with daisy chains, they're all in party mood. Toffle could go and talk to them, no one would think him rude. But who will comfort Toffle? Who will tell him in the end, if all you do is hide away, you'll never find a friend? A few miles further on, and Toffle's shoes begin to pinch. His feet are sore and tired, he cannot move another inch. He parks his trusty suitcase underneath the sun's bright glare. What a relief, thinks Toffle, that I've got a comfy chair. And as he sits, soft music floods his ears from far away, where Snufkin plays his silver flute in summer's sleepy bay. Snufkin has never had a heavy load or painful feet. He wanders through green fields of flowers. His life must be a treat. But who will comfort Toffle and persuade him that a song is better than a suitcase when the road is hard and long? So Toffle trudges westwards, though in fact he doesn't know where he'll end up or what to do or where on earth to go. And as he tiptoes through the woods, he hears the sound of bells and spots some merry Woompas spinning round on carousels. Dancers with flowers on their tails and lights as bright as moons, and heaps of pancakes stuffed with jam and cakes and macaroons. While Himmelin lights fireworks near the tall umbrella trees, how lonely it must feel to be a Toffle no one sees. So who will comfort Toffle and explain the way things go? They'd know that he was there if he would only say hello. Toffle picks up his case and makes his way towards the beach. He sees a big white shell. What luck, it's just within his reach. He pulls his shoes off, feels his toes sink into soft white sand, as he admires the pale blue sky, the sea, the rippling land. How wonderful, thinks Toffle, I can rest or dance or shout, or fill my hat with pebbles. Even so, he can't work out. Why, he is still not happy. There is no one in his way. No Himmelin or Groke nearby. He ought to feel okay. So who will comfort Toffle and remind him that a shell is nicer when there's somebody to show it to as well? In shallow water near the shore, mysteries are afloat. Toffle can see a bottle, and inside it there's a note. He paddles out to rescue it, to see what it might say. If it was signed, the sea has washed its signature away. But Toffle has the moon, which is the perfect reading lamp. He'll try to work it out, although the words are blurred and damp. He reads aloud, "I'm terrified. Won't someone come and help? Won't somebody protect me when the Groke begins to yelp? If you are strong and wise and brave, please will you call or write? I'm just a little mythful, and it's very nearly night." Toffle can't bear to think of it, a girl alone and sad. His heart beats fast. This letter is the first he's ever had. He folds it carefully in half and keeps it near his chest, feeling as if it's meant for him, though it was not addressed. He leaves his hat and shoes behind and takes a gentle dip. Only a small one, though. The sea's too cold without a ship. Toffle decides. He empties out the pebbles from his case, then climbs inside and rows away, keeping a steady pace. The moonlight winks, and Toffle thinks, "I'm happy. Yes, indeed. I know a mythful needs me, and a mythful's all I need." So Toffle sails past three black whales, each with a waterspout. The sky is gray, a gloomy day. Toffle hears someone shout, "By Jove, I'm cold! It's Himmelin!" His voice is hoarse and gruff. Inside his rubber ring, he wriggles, "Brr, I've had enough." And Toffle says quite shyly, "I am absolutely sure, if you'll excuse my saying so, that we have met before." Philly Junk, in her party frock, waves as she floats nearby. Nine Woompas pass in six blue boats, and number five says hi. "I should reply," thinks Toffle, "since she said hello to me. But who will comfort Mythful if I dawdle endlessly?" The Groke's black mountain hideaway looms over Toffle's head. "I think I'll visit Booble, where his fishing net is spread," says Toffle. "But I'd best be quick and not get in the way of Booble and his friends, the Woompas, on their holiday." "Excuse me, Booble, but has a Mythful passed your fishing rod?" "Yes, I believe she has," says Booble. "It was rather odd. She flew past in a panic just a day or so ago. And as for where she ended up, well, only Groke would know." "Toffle, I'd love to have you spend the afternoon with me, but who will comfort Mythful if you linger by the sea?" Night falls as Toffle wanders through a forest where the swarms of bats all shake their wings at him, and little furry forms of creatures brush against his legs, and pairs of peering eyes stare from among the tree trunks. He hears whispers, growls, and cries. And though he's very frightened, Toffle knows he must be brave. There is a frightened Mythful that he simply has to save. He dives inside the nearest hole as Groke begins to shriek, but makes himself climb out again. "How can I be so weak?" He stamps an angry foot. At last, rage has replaced his fear. Scared Mythfuls need brave Toffles when the frightful Groke appears. What is this dark, silent place? Is it the Groke's black yard? Yes, if the moon is hiding and the ground is frozen hard, and here's the Groak with his yellow eyes, a fierce and awful sight, chilling the air around her, turning afternoon to night. Toffle is very nervous. If he makes a small mistake, his plan might fail. He knows it has to work for Miffle's sake. Toffle begins his battle dance and hopes that he can win. When Groak is least expecting it, he bites her on the shin. Groak howls and runs away. Poor Miffle, always quick to scare, is even quicker to console now Groak's no longer there. Now Toffle looks at Miffle. They exchange a timid smile that says as much as words, perhaps, but only for a while. Since there are certain things that even smiles cannot express, I'll write to you instead, says Toffle. That's the answer, yes. But when he tries to write about how lonely he's been, about the house in Himalayan, the smooth white shell he's seen, the Groak, the night he sailed the sea, he finds no words will come. He is too shy to write his tale. Poor Toffle is struck dumb. So who will comfort Toffle now? Will someone lend a hand and help him write to Miffle so that she can understand? Find some writing paper. You won't need a stamp. Just stick the letter on a rose bush where you're sure Miffle will see it. When Miffle reads the letter, which she finds a little tough, Toffle's peculiar signature is difficult enough. Her roses turn from white to red right before Miffle's eyes. Miffle falls into Toffle's arms, gives him a hug, and cries. Forget the past and all your fears. Think of the super fun that we can have. I'd love to see the beach, a shell, the sun. So off they sail, two special guests on Philly Junk's red boat. The Woompas wave and cheer to see the happy pair afloat. And Miffle knows, and Toffle knows, that both have seen the end, a fear and fright and long dark night. Now each has found a friend. Here are Toffle and Miffle, living happily ever after. The end.